Hare Krishna. So, please bless me that I do not speak any nonsense, no ill motive, no any prejudice while speaking on this sensitive subject matters. Hare Krishna. So you can see that in our lives, at some point, we all encounter this element which is called sex. So how do we look at it with Krishna conscious view? So here we go. See, in our Vedic way of life, the life has been divided into four parts. First one is called Brahmachari, celibate student. Student, at the tender age of 5, he goes to the place of spiritual master, where he is trained for spiritual realization and also in the material affairs of life. But definitely, he follows the vow of Brahmacharya, celibacy. And then when he reaches at the age of 25, or bit before that, if he wants, he can enter the married order of life. He can become a married man, he can become a householder, or if he wants, he can enter the renounced order of life. He does not need to go through the troubles of family life. But most of us, as we see, that enter the married life. So there is a Brahmachari, celibate student life, and then there is a married life, and after married life, there is a section called Vanprastha, Vanprasthan, departure to the forest. It is a stage before the renounced order of life, which is called sannyas. So Brahmachari, Grihast, Vanprast, and sannyas. So we can see that in the three stages of life, among four, there is no sex life. In Brahmachari, definitely no. In Grihastha life, yes, there is some concession. Some people think that if I become a married man, I would have license to have unrestricted sexual pleasure. No, this is not the case. In married life, some concession is given. Sexual life is there, but it is regulated, it is restricted. And then in Vanprastha, when one goes to forest, one's wife is with him, but again, one is not allowed physical intimacy. And again, after that sannyasa, no question. Even one's wife is not with him. Actually, in sannyasa section of life, a sannyasi is not even allowed to look at his wife from the previous ashram. So what to speak about having physical union? So we can see that basically in Vedic way of life, sex life has been condemned. No sex in Brahmachari, no sex in Vanprastha, and no sex in sannyasa life. Some discount has been given for Grihastha, because there would be many people like myself who have to go through this experience. For example, I was a celibate student for many years in one of the Hare Krishna temple, but then the sexual urges start haunting, and then I felt the need for becoming a married man. And see what happens. I was one. We call it Dvibhuj, the man with two arms. And then I became Chaturbhuj, The man with four arms means I got my wife, four hands. And then I became Shadbhuj, one child came. And then I became Ashtbhuj, another child came. And then I became Dashbhuj, another child came. So see how, because of that sex impulse, family life is created. I was one, then I became two, then three, then four, then five. So that's why some people who are very, very intelligent, they don't like to go through the trouble of family life. They immediately enter the renounce part of their life. So anyway, it is said that for a brahmachari, for a student, brahmacharya is very, very essential. But nowadays, in this DNA age, students are not taught about the importance of celibacy. One time, I remember I met with one boy, young boy, and he had a baby. I inquired from him, how old are you? He said, I am 14 years old. And I said, who is this baby? And he said, it is my baby. And I was shocked. And I said, where is your wife? He said, I do not have a wife. And I said, so how did you get the baby? He said, I got this baby from my girlfriend. I said, where is your girlfriend? He said, I am separated. He was dropping bombs after bombs on me. So I felt sorry for him, such a tender age. And he had just lost his energy in such a tender age. So people in the West and even in other countries where there was a lot of value for celibacy, they are losing that very conception. It is said by Yagvalkya Muni that Mansa Vacha Karmana Sarva Avastasu Sarvada Sarvatra Methuna Tyaga Brahmacharyam Prachakshite. That definition of celibacy is that one should give up sex pleasure by thought, by action, by mind, in all the circumstances, in all situations, forever, all the time. That is the definition of celibacy. But nowadays, that conception is lost. When we talk about celibacy, some people, they laugh. They make a joke. When I used to be a celibate student, sometime when I was preaching and people would ask me, are you a brahmachari? And I said, yes. And they didn't believe it. And I had to give many, many arguments to support myself. Even one of them asked, do you put kopin or langot? Now those of you who do not know what is langot, langot is a small piece of cloth which one puts tight around one's private part in the case of a male. So they ask me, why don't you show us your kopin or your langot? And believe me, literally I had to show them. And then they believed that I am a brahmachari. So, anyway, so in the Western world, this word brahmachari is unheard of. For example, in Bhagavad Gita, in chapter 6, verse number 14, the word brahmacharya has been used by Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna says that brahmacharyam vrate sthita, that a yogi has to be situated in that status of celibacy. But nowadays, those people who are into yoga, they have no idea of that. People think that I can become a yogi and same time I can have unregulated, unrestricted sexual pleasure. But Krishna is not recommending that. Krishna is saying that brahmachari vrate sthitha, that one should be celibate. So those people who are doing yoga practice and are engaged in sexual pleasure at the same time, according to Prabhupada, they might be doing some kind of gymnastic or physical exercise, but actually they are wasting their time. Now you will say, well, if I cannot have sex pleasure, why should I become devotee? Why should I devote my time to God consciousness? I need this pleasure as well. I have a sexual appetite. What should I do? So, in that case, there is also an instruction in Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita, chapter 7, verse number 11, 7:11, where Krishna says that balam balam vatam chaham kama raga vivarjitam dharam aviruddho bhuteshu kamo asmi bhartarshava. Krishna is saying to Arjuna that I am that sex life which is not contrary to the religious principles. It means Krishna is saying that one can have sex if it is within the range of the permission from the holy books. So one is allowed to have sex when one is married. No illicit relation, but licit sex is allowed. Many times His Divine Grace Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada said in his lectures that sex life is not denied. It is not prohibited, but it is regulated. Even sometimes he called marriage life as licensed prostitution. So some license is given in a married life, so one can have some regulated sexual pleasure in order to bring forth Krishna conscious children. So when there is a need for that, when there is a ritu kaal, when the female is agitated after that menstrual period, 5 days after that, one is allowed to have sex, to have children, but not for the purpose of whimsical gratification. Otherwise, we would fall in the category of cats and dogs. So this human life is meant for self-realization, and one has to retain one's energy. In case of men, they are known as urdhavareta. They pull their semen upwards. It goes to brain, and then it helps them to develop the fine tissues of the brain, so they can understand the spiritual subject matters. So the point is that it does not matter. It is material life or spiritual life. One is supposed to save that energy. Otherwise, it would be a wastage of time. Hare Krishna. Thank you.